Bishop of the Hungarian Reformed Church from Romania, Transylvania, then an elected member of the European Parliament with the headquarters in Brussels. It is quite a huge change in my life that after being a simple minister of my church, I became a member of the European Parliament. I was persecuted priest of a persecuted church, a minority Hungarian church. We lived in double minority situation. First minority, both on religious and ethnic relationship. And as a double minority in an atheist and anti-Hungarian nationalist state, our situation was very difficult, and we had to face the last Stalinist type communist dictatorship of Nicolae Ceausescu. He was a megaloman communist dictator who deprived the Romanian people of all his rights, the fundamental human rights, inter alia, the freedom of speech, the freedom of assembly, the freedom of conscience and thought. The minority people were deprived of their minority rights. In my church, we could not preach freely. Our sermons were surveilled, and spies, mebesugók, hogy mondják, spies, and spies were surveilling our full activity. We had not the right to teach the children of the parish or to organize the youth activity in the church. We had no Bibles, we had no hymn books. It was interdicted, or when our Western brothers and sisters gave us a series of Bibles, that was a very well-known and shocking case, when 10,000 Bibles, 10,000 copies of Bible were given by Western sister churches. All these Bibles were sent into the paper mill, and hygienic paper was made out of the Bibles. This case was demanded later on, and it provoked a large scandal against the bishop, my former bishop. Later on, I was elected in place of him. The majority of the clergy, by the way, Pop László, the majority of the clergymen, the high clergymen, were allies of the atheist communist dictator, and they were collaborating even in the persecution of the ministers, of the pastors of the church. We tried to to stand up against this kind of state and spiritual church oppression and that was the main reason of these persecutions. The Hungarian community from Transylvania was the object of a Romanian assimilation policy as far as 100 years ago. We counted about 50%, the minorities in Transylvania counted close to 50% of the population of Transylvania. I mean Hungarians, Germans, Jews, and other minorities. At this moment in Romania, we are belonging to minorities only about 20%. So in 100 years, and mostly in the time of Ceausescu, in the time of the dictatorial communist regime, our number, our proportion, our number as well, our proportion was reduced to close to 20%. It was made by assimilation policy and on the other side by the betelepítés, hogy mondják, the settlement, by settlement of ethnic Romanians from the old Romanian kingdom. At the same time, the Romanian Orthodox Church was a privileged majority church in Romania. They still have the quality of a state church as far as minority churches as Roman Catholic, Reformed, or Evangelical, in general the Protestant churches are second-ranked churches and have to suffer many discrimination and disadvantages in different in different regards. We had to suffer many disadvantages in our professional career. The professors, the Hungarian ethnic Hungarian professors, were placed in remote majority regions, Romanian regions of the old Romanian kingdom, over the Carpathians, where no Hungarians are living, so they could not practice their professorship, and they could not serve their people, and but the ministers, in the case of the ministers, it is very similar. The ministers, the pastors of the Reformed Church, for example, were placed in tiny mixed villages where there are no many believers. Simply we had no possibility to execute our mission, to practice our mission, because there was a this kind of disadvantaging treatment towards the ministers who were faithful to their people and their God. And I was an assistant minister. Long time I could not be elected as a full right pastor minister in a large community because of my attitude, of my anti-communist attitude. And that was the case, for example, in Timișoara. In Timișoara, I was put as an assistant minister, in Brașov also, Brasov-Kronstadt, or at the beginning of my career in Brasov, or later on in Dej, another city, I could be nominated only an assistant minister, but other colleagues of mine were sent far in remote villages where they could not have relations with the society, with the heart of the church. So they tried to move me from Timișoara in 89. They moved me in a little village where only about 120 believers, parishioners are living, to isolate from the large church. Communists had many administrative tools to disadvantage those who were not loyal to the atheist regime, and in this regard the clergy itself was so much humiliated and enrolled in the system of the communist regime that they were obedient executors of the Romanian communist anti-Hungarian, anti-church policy. The Stalinism was very, very cruel towards different ethnic and national communities. The Holodomor took place also in Ukraine, where about 6 to 7 million people died starvation. Some 6 to 7, where some 6 to 7 million Ukrainian people died of starvation. Ceausescu was very democratic in this sense, if I can say so. All the people were starving in his time, not to death, but starving. For example, in my time, at the end of in the second part of the 80s, the food was distributed according to a ratio. Romania was so much indebted, eladósodott. So he was so much indebted that Ceausescu wanted to acquit these debts in a relatively short time, and because of the bad economic policy, he put the people to pay the price of the bad administration and bad economic policy, and we had to suffer for it. As far as the Communist Party was paid and was favorized in even in economic relations. So in the everyday activity of my parishes were such problems. For example, when I arrived to Dej, a town from the middle of Transylvania, I started a movement of evangelization amongst the youth, and on the other side we we made a cultural activity in our Hungarian mother tongue, because Hungarian children were in were losing their language, their mother tongue. They were sent to Romanian schools, forcibly sent to Romanian schools to forget their Hungarian language and to be assimilated. We were not against Romanians and Romanian culture, of course, or Romanian language, but we were protecting our Hungarian heritage, our Hungarian identity. In this activity, we had to face all the time the presence of the Securitate and that of the Romanian Communist Party. Our activity was prohibited, different administrative restrictions were introduced against us. Then the bishop was my bishop was forced to move me in a little village. So that case happened repeatedly. I was removed from Dej to a remote village because of being punished for my activity, and then from Timișoara I was moved to another little village as a punishment for my faithful activity for my people, for my church. And these were the everyday harassment and persecution for anything what you did. If you spoke about, if you preached about the truth of God, and you gave an example from the society, from the everyday social life, that was surveilled, and you were called to the Securitate, but there were major cases, as for example when we launched a movement for the Hungarian schools, because as far as in the 50s there was a autonomous Hungarian school system. In the beginning with the 60s, 70s, the regimes start to close the Hungarian schools and to prohibit and step by step Romanized the Hungarian school system. We tried to recover the Hungarian school, the Hungarian language teaching, the Hungarian teaching, the Hungarian school system, and started a movement trying to convince the Hungarian parents to keep faithful to their Hungarian identity, and to send their children and to fight for Hungarian schools for their children. In this case, all my family, we are 8 sisters and brothers, all my family were involved in this movement, or all our friends, many ministers from the different minority churches were involved in this movement, and week by week and month by month we were called to the Securitate and persecuted and threatened, and our family members were threatened, and some of the colleagues had lost their jobs, and their family members had to suffer disadvantages. Most well-known, the best-known case is that our speaking out against the so-called village systematization plan of Ceausescu, which, as a matter of fact, was a plan of the destroyment of about 7,000 villages, the demolition of about 7,000 villages. That was the last the last phase of the Ceausescu regime. In this, Ceausescu was a good disciple of Deng Xiaoping. They visited China and they wanted to introduce a kind of communist regime as it was in China, or much more a system which is still functioning in North Korea. They wanted to transform Romania into the society of humble and equal right people members of society without rights and with a new conscience, collectivism, collective conscience. The most brutal and cruel period was that after the Second World War, when the communism, the Bolshevik communism, was introduced in the eastern part of Europe. For example, the Romanian Greek Catholic Church totally was banned, with about 2,000 of churches and about 1 million of believers. And it was made as in the Soviet Empire, for example, in Ukraine. This church was banned. Ministers and pastors, the generation of my father, for example, who is also a minister and was a deputy bishop in my church, they were all imprisoned, harassed, and restricted in an unbelievable measure. Many were died in prison or in deportation camps, mostly those of the ministers of the minority churches. Later on, liberalization took place, mostly in the 60s and 70s, but in the second part of the reign of Ceausescu, and after the close contacts with China and the Arab world, the Arab dictatorships. For example, he was very good relation with Saddam Hussein, Ceausescu, in the 80s, mostly in the 80s, a kind of neo-Stalinism was installed in Romania, and the most terrific and provoking plan of this period was the demolition of the plan of the demolition of the villages. Ceausescu imagined a society where people receives everything per ratio and a kind of falanszter, tehát egy falanszter társadalom, mint az ember tragédiában, mindenki egyenlő, mindenki az államnak a szolgája, mindenki kínai vagy észak-koreai módra be van szervezve egy településre. Megszabják, hogy mikor kell, mikor fekszik, mennyit eszik, mennyit iszik, és teljesen el akarták törölni a hagyományos társadalmi rendet, vagyis mintegy 7000 falut akartak lebontani, néhánynak a bontása már el is kezdődött, és ezeket adminisztratív központokba akarták költöztetni ezeknek a falvaknak a népét, megszabták, hogy mi lehet a minimális nagyságú falu. Ha jól emlékszem, a minimális lakosság az 50 ezer kellett volna legyen. Ezeket jól meg tudta volna szervezni a hatalom, a szekuritáte, a titkosszolgálata ezeknek az ellenőrzését, ezeknek az embereknek az ellenőrzését. Szinte munkatáborokba akarták szervezni őket, munkahely és lakóhely szerves egységében képzelte el Ceausescu ezt a rendszert, és mindent a földdel egyenlővé akartak tenni, temetőket, városokat, templomokat lebontani, és akkor ez volt az a pont, ahol már nem lehetett hallgatni. Mindenki meg volt rémülve, már Bukarest környékén elkezdték a bontásokat, közben lebontott Ceausescu vagy 40 templomot és kolostort ott Bukarest környékén, az ő palotáját is egy olyan helyen építette fel, ahol lebontotta azt a városrészt Bukarestben. A világ legnagyobb megalomániával épített palotája, a népháza. Ott is sokan haltak meg egyébként, mert olyan munkásokat vittek, ilyen atombunker épült alatta, és vannak, akiket nem engedtek ki, főleg ilyen büntetett előéletű embereket vittek oda, hogy ne tudja senki, hogy mi épül ott a palota alatt. Nos, itt a falurombolás ellen we spoke out against the demolition of the villages. I myself with one of my colleagues formulated a memorandum against the demolition of the villages, and we forwarded we előterjesztettük ezt a we put forward this paper at a meeting of the pastors of Temesvár deaconate, and the priests from that deaconate all voted this document to be sent to the synod of my church, respectively to the Romanian Communist Party and the official Romanian authorities. In this paper we protested against the demolition of the villages. This was the first collective and official protest against the demolition of the villages. This was my biggest sin later on, this determined the Securitate to remove me from Timișoara to that to a little village in the Szilágyi County in Menyő. Ceausescu was the object of a religious like adoration, and the cult of personality was as large as in the case of Fidel Castro or Kim Jong-il and other, or Deng Xiaoping and others, or Stalin in the former times. Our protest was an unimaginable act in that time, in 88. It took place in 88, and it was made public by TV, radio, so it was a very scandalous case, and we risked our life indeed, but it was necessary, because one had to stop and to break down Ceausescu. It was an irrational kind of the cult of the cult of personality and of communist abuses. Ceausescu had a very good techniques of hiding the true face of dictatorship. So, as probably many people knows, he was received by the president of the United States. His wife was awarded as a scientist, as although she was not even a cultivated woman. Ceausescu was considered, because of his act of protest against the Soviet Union in the time of the spring from Praga, the spring of Prague. He was considered the champion of the peace in Eastern Europe. He had a good reputation. He had a very good image-making propaganda in that time. So, in this case of the demolition of the villages, we appealed to the Romanian laws, so they had to hide their real intentions, and they made use of the bishop and the church to hide those pastors who were unpleasant for the communist regime. In those times, some pastors have died in unknown circumstances, or disappeared, or were put out from their jobs, and you could not be sure that it cannot happen with you. The Romanian society was intimidated. Nobody dared to speak out, for example, against this unimaginable plan of destroying the whole system of localities and villages. And it was directed mostly against Hungarian villages, Hungarian churches, Hungarian cemeteries. Romanians were ethnic Romanians, about 2 million ethnic Romanians were newcomers. They had no old churches, old localities, so they were not nem voltak érintve ebben. Do not only as a student when we were obliged to go on the street and to receive the visit of Ceausescu, the conducator, the Führer of, a kind of Führer of Romania, and we had to applaud him, and it was obligatory to participate at this event in the center of Kolozsvár, Cluj-Napoca. According to my profession and my creed, I was very much committed for justice and freedom and for the service, to serve my people, those oppressed, those humiliated. And from my early childhood, being brought up in a minister's family and having the tradition, the Christian evangelical tradition of the Bible and of my church, it was something very evident and obvious that I have to do my best for as a minister and in the protection and in the service of my people. Believers in that time were aware of the dangers and the risks of our activity and our opposition, but as you know from other countries, for example, the case of the Polish Roman Catholic Church or that of Father Popieluszko, or as we know the resistance of the Evangelical Lutheran Church from Eastern Germany, which has to assume that role of opposing the dictatorship, an oppressive regime. Along the history of Christian Church, there were such periods when the church had to suffer even martyrdom. Even in the time of the Hitlerist Germany, the church had to take position against the Nazi regime. So we had to do in the time of the ACs, Soviet type communist regime, and concretely in the time of the Ceausescu dictatorship. I was very happy in a sense, in the deep sense of the word, because and I was very calm. I read the word of God from the Bible, and I understood that according to Christ, we have to face the evil, we have to do our best, we have to not only to preach, but also to act. And as a good surgeon, orvos, úgy mondják, as a good surgeon who is fighting against the illnesses and has to overcome the sickness, we have to do the same on social level in the everyday life. That was the negative side of our life. Of course, we were sometimes frightened, and we were féltünk, hogy mondjam.
Afraid.
We were afraid, of course. We were afraid, but the courageous man is who succeeds to overcome his being of, okay, le tudja győzni a félelmét, hogy mondja.
He conquered his fear.
The courageous, the brave man is who can conquer his fear. So we had to do so, and thanks to God we succeeded to do so. In 89, there were only two alternatives. Or Ceausescu falls, or we will be who will be even killed in the worst case. And thanks to God, Ceausescu fell, and that was celebrating all the Romanian society, and the start was quite miraculous and emotional. That December of 89, but later on, in a very short time, the so-called revolution, Romanian revolution, was kidnapped and transformed into a simple putsch of second-line communists. In front of them with Ion Iliescu, and managed by the Securitate itself. That's terrible that the Securitate not only saved his position, but distorted the way of the whole revolution, and broke down the change of regime, which started 25 years ago. You can hardly find a credible personality of the Romanian Revolution in the far front, az élen, hogy mondják?
On the forefront.
Forefront. You can hardly find a credible representative of the Romanian Revolution in the forefront of the Romanian social and political life at this moment. My case is a very special one, as I succeeded as a Hungarian to get to be elected and to get into the European Parliament, so it is not typical. The typical is, even regarding me, that we are all the time the target of the attacks directed by the Securitate and the post-communist rule, which is now embodied by the Prime Minister Victor Ponta. It had a relative success, because and so it was in all the countries of the Soviet bloc, more or less, took place a change, a relatively peaceful change. In Romania it was not so peaceful. Here were about 1,500 victims of the terror in the times of the fall of the dictatorship, but more or less the change of regime started. But look at these countries. Despite of being a member of the European Union, we have the heritage. We have the heritage of communism, and in consequence, we have to inherit the crisis of communism, because here in Romania we can speak not only about a general crisis of the European countries or a global crisis, but here in this part of the of Europe we have to speak about a inherited crisis from the communism. The results of the fall of the regime, of fall of communism, are very relative. Many people have nostalgia for the time of Ceausescu, for the a kind of minimal security of that society in comparison with the present situation, when there is a deep gap between the moody, a jó módúak és a szegények között, hogy mondják, the rich, and there is a deep gap between the two parts of the two sides of the society, those being rich and those the poor people of the society. They are sometimes dissatisfied with a kind of political insularism of United States, that the United States is disregarding the communist terror and heritage from Eastern Central Europe. And sometimes they are ignoring this communist heritage, and that is why I was very much moved by the gesture of Lee Edwards and the Victims of Communism Memorial Foundation, that they revived the case of the memory and the sacrifice of those fighting against communism. But, without facing the communist past, we cannot continue our fight for democracy and for full freedom of Hungarians and other slave nations who are living in this part of the world. And in this regard, this is the best call of the United States, which has the heritage of the being the champion for democracy and freedom in the world. The United States that has not to forget this calling and this mission, and I hope that that the new museum for the victims of communism, which is prepared to be built up, will represent and embody this idea of the champion for freedom and democracy of the United States.